Guys, welcome back. Have you ever woken up in the morning to find your battery completely dead and your system shut down? Over-discharging your battery can shorten its life. If you have a flooded battery or a battery without a BMS, or simply want to control power to your AC loads, you might find this useful. These types of inverters are dumb inverters. They are not programmable and they do not care about your battery's voltage. They will simply keep running until your battery is completely dead or can no longer sustain the AC loads connected to it. So while your inverter may not care about your battery voltage, your charge controller does. Today, I'm going to show you how to use the load port on your charge controller to control power to your inverter using one of these, a contactor. Let's get started. So a 4-pin relay will have a coil, plus 12 volts and minus 12 volts. That activates the coil here. There's a coil right here. And this is the coil here. And this is basically an electromagnet. So when power is applied to the coil, this energizes and then this switch right here closes. And then power goes from A1 to A2. That's basically how it works. It's an electrical switch. So with this contactor, these two main lugs here are your switch. So it's A1 and A2. And the two wires here are the coil, the plus 12 volts and minus 12 volts. So when we put 12 volts to this, to these wires, the switch will contact and these two power can flow from this lug to this lug. A contactor is essentially a heavy duty relay. A relay is an electrical switch that can control a large amount of current, like from your battery to your inverter, with a small amount of current. This particular contactor is from an EV car and normally costs around $300, but you can get these on batteryhookup.com very cheap. See link below. These also use very little current when activated, less than 1 amp. So here I have a very simple circuit. I have a 12 volt lead wired up to a switch. And when I turn the switch on, the light turns on. So let's see how a contactor or a relay can replace the switch. All right, so like any relay, once you energize it, you should hear a clicking sound. So this is what we're going to do. So that clicking sound is the switch right here engaging when this coil is energizing. We're energizing that coil, closing that switch. So what we're going to do is imitate the function of the regular switch we had, and we're going to connect our light to here and show you how this basically works. All right, so this is really shoddy wiring, but basically, if I were to connect the positive to here, right to the here, right, that completes our circuit and the light comes on. Over here, nothing happens because we have to energize the relay to contact from here to here. Jam this one in here. All right, now when I engage the contactor, the current will flow from here to here and activate our light. And that's basically how it works. So the load port on your charge controller is mainly used to power DC devices like 12 volt appliances or USB LED lights like this one. So depending on the charge controller you have, they are programmable to where you can have your load turn on at nighttime when the solar panels are not producing any power, and then automatically turn off the load when the sun comes up and the panels are producing power. So over the winter, I'm going to be running my holiday lighting with this outdoor solar system. I'm using a heated LiFePool 4 battery that I DIY'd. See the video and link right here how I built this battery. So this battery will be able to handle the winter temps. But I do not want to run the lights during the day, and I do not want to over-discharge my battery during the night. We will use the load port on the charge controller to drive the actuator side on the contactor. We will use the switch side of the contactor to control power from the battery to our inverter. In this system, the contactor acts just like the DC disconnect switch, turning on and off power to the inverter. Just to show you the lights with the AC inverter, let's wire it up. Since my battery has a Bluetooth BMS, I could program the BMS to shut down the battery, but that could shut down the charge controller as well. I'd rather not rely on the BMS for this job. If you have an SLA or flooded battery, you do not have this option as they do not have a BMS. Besides, it would not allow me to disconnect its load at nighttime. This is why the charge controller is the best way to implement this. Okay, now we got our contactor wired up to our load port on the charge controller. If I turn on the load from the charge controller, we should hear the clicking sound. I love that sound. That's great.
Okay, so the next step is to route our battery power through the contactor and up to the DC cutoff switch. So we're going to use this little jumper wire. We're going to go from our battery stud here up to the A1 lug on the contactor. Should be okay. All right, now we're going to have our switch going to the A2 or the output side of the contactor. Okay, good. Our battery comes through to the lug, up to our contactor input, through the output, and up to our DC disconnect switch. Got the switch in the on position, but now the charge controller is off because the contactor is off. So the charge controller has to have power to the battery at all times so it knows how to turn on the contactor. So we have to take this wire right here and route it to the battery side so that it always has power. So we're just going to have to put this over here for now. Okay. The big moment. Everything's hooked up. Now there's two ways we can activate our contactor. We can press the button on the front of the charge controller. It's so cool. I love it. Or we can use the Bluetooth app. That's so cool. So we're controlling our AC loads with our charge controller. What's so useful? Whenever that inverter turns on, it puts out so much RF noise. That's what you get for a $150 inverter. So now that that works, let's program our charge controller and make it do what we want it to do. All right, so there's two things we need to do with our charge controller. We need to program it so that it's in automatic mode, so that when the solar panels stop producing at nighttime, the lights turn on. And then in the daytime, when the solar panel turns on, the lights turn off. So we just want to run the lights at nighttime. So that's pretty easy to do. All we have to do is go to status mode and change it to light control. Now if you do any 1 to 24 hours, that's going to be basically when the sun goes down, it'll stay on for 1 to 14 hours. But we want to do 24 hours. Basically, if there's light, turn it off. If there's darkness, then turn it on. So just the first option, light control. Your controller might be different, but you're just looking for something that's automatic mode. Now to test it, since we're in the day, we should be able to just turn off our solar right here, and it should turn on the load. Turn off our solar. Now the little nighttime icon popped up. It takes a minute before it actually realize, because there's like a delay in case the panels are shaded or whatever. Quite a delay. Wonder how long it takes. Okay, so I went into the old Renogy app. Renogy did this, but they removed, in the new app, they dumbed it down. So they removed all the advanced features. You can't fine tune, and you can't see what the settings are like behind the scenes. So I went in the old app, and under light control, the light control delay was set to 10, so it was a 10-minute delay. I set it down to 1 minute, and now it's on light control. So when I turn off the solar, wait about a minute, and the light. There it is. And our lights are on. So now we're going to turn the solar panel back on, and these lights should in turn turn off. So the breaker's on. Watch for our solar panel power coming in here. 31 volts, 166 watts. So now we got solar coming in, and these should turn off in about a minute. Something pretty significant. There it is. Alright, so the light portion is figured out. Now we got to do the battery. We're going to go ahead and program the low voltage disconnect, which is the main feature I'm trying to stress in this video. Problem right we're going to have is our voltage, it's going to take like 2 hours to discharge this battery, right? So we don't have time for that. charge controller thinks the voltage is at 13.2. So we're going to have to put this rather high just for demonstration's sake. So right now the low voltage warning is 12 and the low voltage disconnect is 11.9. So you're going to want to change, at the very least, the low voltage disconnect. So we'll go ahead and bump this up to 13, for example. Normally you would want it, you know, rather low. And the reconnect is also important because it's going to wait until the battery recovers with solar charging or whether with some other means of charging up to that voltage, and then it'll reconnect the load. So you can't have that too low. It will need to be higher than your voltage disconnect. So you would have like your disconnect set to like 11, say, and then your reconnect would be like 11.5 or 12. All right, so in the settings, I've got the tolerances pretty tight. So we have a over discharge return as 13.1, and our low voltage and over discharge and over discharge limit is all set to 13. I have a space heater hooked up to the inverter. When I turn on that space heater, it's gonna create a huge amp draw and it's gonna drop the voltage. The charge controller will see that and it'll disconnect the load. As soon as that happens, the battery voltage will come back up to 13.1, and then the charge controller will then turn on the inverter back on. So it's going to be a very quick cycle. Just to show you how we cross that threshold as the battery voltage drops, and then it shuts off, and then the battery returns, and then it engages and turns back on. So I'm going to turn it on real quick, and we're going to see it cycle. Now it's in a loop. The reason why I did it twice and then stopped, the charge controller can see during normal operation, if we didn't have such a heavy load, the battery voltage is going to gradually come down, right? And then once it crosses that threshold, it's going to turn off and cycle, and then the battery voltage will recover because there's no longer a load on it. Well, you can't keep on going back and forth in a continual loop. It's not good for the system to be on and off, especially at a high amp draw. So the charge controller sees that, and it sees, okay, after two times, so the first delay is 5 seconds, and the second time it does it, it's gonna be longer, and then the third time, I think it just turns off indefinitely, or it turns off until the next morning when the solar panel starts charging. So just be mindful of that. So here I have an external breaker, and this has a cool feature on it where if you had a heavy load and it was interrupted for whatever reason, a short, and the power was disconnected from the input side of this breaker, you have to hit this button in order to restore power to whatever load that tripped the fault in the first place. So if you want to prevent that looping from happening, you could always just get one of these. So since this heater has just a manual switch, as soon as power is restored to the inverter, the heater comes right back on. So if you want to prevent that, now I have the heater on, but this has to be turned on to activate the heater. So once I turn this on, it'll cycle, and then this will not turn back on, keeping our load off. So this tripped, and now look, see, this did not come back on, because this has to be activated. So it's a cool little device. So remember I told you this particular contactor has a very low amp draw because it's usually used in EV cars and they want to preserve the battery as much as possible. So if I turn off that, we can look at our load output. 0.41 amps. So that's less than half an amp. That's really good. Look, 0.19 amps. That's crazy low. That's really good. Like 2 watts just to keep this thing. A little automotive Bosch style relay uses 2 amps, and this huge thing uses just 0.21 amps. That's crazy. Alright, so we're gonna have to really get this down here to make this a practical test. So let's do 11.9. Okay, so 11.9, so hopefully it stays on for longer than a 30 seconds stay on, but it's not too low. We're gonna be sitting here for an hour. So this could probably run for maybe 10 minutes or so before it hits 11.9. conservative, you can do 3.1 times 4, that'd be 12.4 volts. But I think anywhere from like 11.8 to 12 is good. So we should be pulling about 130, 150 amps through this right here. So we make sure this contactor is not getting too hot. 132 amps. We're sitting at 82 degrees on our contactor terminals, so that's really good. So this thing can definitely handle some power, some amps. It's funny because the current on the load port is 0.45 amps. In reality, we're controlling 135 amps with this contactor. If you had that plugged into the load port would explode. The load port's only good for 20 amps. So we're going off what the charge controller thinks is the voltage, and it's definitely different than what the BMS says. So if you have a Bluetooth BMS, you might want to go off of you might have to tweak your settings on your charge controller to make up for that discrepancy, right? Because there's a difference of like 0.4 volts. So you have to adjust, make this 0.4 deeper on your charge controller settings so that your actual voltage on your battery is, you're getting more out of your battery, but you're still doing it safely. I'm gonna creep this up. I just want this thing to shut off. Now I should do this for a couple times before it finally goes in air mode. It's not air mode, it just knows, hey, we gotta stop this from looping. All right, so yeah, this worked better than I expected. It's actually a really elegant solution to a common problem. So I'm gonna go hang some lights. So with the Renergy charge controller, if it's on automatic or light mode, you cannot use the button on the front or the Bluetooth app to then switch the load on and off whenever you want. So if it's on, it has to be on manual mode and then you can use the button, or light mode, then you cannot use the button. It's kind of stupid. Renergy really needs to fix it. It's just a firmware programming issue. If you're thinking of getting one of these, make sure that the max continuous amp rating is equal to or greater than your system's maximum amperage value it can pull. The one I used in the video is a 500 amp. Another option, instead of using a contactor, is using a smart relay, a programmable relay. I don't have one, so I can't recommend one, but that is another option. It's a 5-pin relay, and it has an extra lug in the normally closed position. So normally when the coil is activated, power is going to go from here to here, but when it's not activated, power is going to go from here to here. So you can effectively reverse the function of the load port light control. So in the daytime, the load can come on, and the nighttime, the load can go off. Now, why would you want to do that? Maybe you want to run a fan during the day and run lights during the night. You can reverse that with a 5-pin relay. You can also use the contactor I showed you, because this one has a carry rate of only 150 amps. It's not meant to be run continuously. I couldn't find very many 5-pin options, but what you could do is use that contactor that I used and use a regular Bosch-style relay like this. This is also a 5-pin relay, but then you use this relay to control this relay to then control your inverter. So I might do another video showing an advanced setup where you have a relay controlling a relay. All right, that's all I got for this video. See you in the next one.